It helps you provide a WhatsApp marketing solutions by providing API integration. So you can call it the Razorpay of WhatsApp marketing world. Can we call that?
No.
No? Okay, better. Hi guys, this is Vaibhav.
Hi, this is Akshay.
And today we'll be discussing about the 24 Indian startups that have entered into Unicorn Club in year 2021. It's a very good number and a very good news for Indian startup ecosystem. And we'll be discussing some of the specific case studies one by one, company-wise, and also we'll be discussing how in an environment of COVID and lockdown, so many startups were able to enter Unicorn Club. So let us start.
I think with every distress, right, you have an opportunity which comes in.
Yeah.
Right? Demonetization was a boon for Paytm and companies like MSwipe, Pine Labs, because everything had to go digital. And I think COVID also gave a lot of opportunity for other players, especially e-commerce, micro-commerce companies to enter into this space, because you had to buy things online, right?
Yeah.
And you were not allowed to go out, and you also didn't want to take the risk to do that. So, you know, I personally feel that every problem that comes creates newer winners over there.
क्या बढ़िया था गुरु.
And I think that is the whole reason why we got so many winners in the corona time for companies to scale up and to become so big.
So in the COVID scenario, there were challenges. But guys, as you said, when challenges come, possibilities. So the user behavior went into massive shifting. Kids started learning
through digital
platform because they were not going to schools. People started ordering stuff. People started getting the stuff delivered rather than going to restaurants. So there was a massive shift in consumer behavior. So the companies were born in during this time, and most of them are remote,
right,
and they have different characteristics. And these companies will be able to handle the pandemics well in future as well. Also, I want to add.
What to say?
Guys, the way investment works is that the funds have, the investment funds, investment houses, they have money, right? And if pandemic is coming or not coming, they still have the money at the end of the day, and they are looking for avenues for investing that money. So in fact, if
and also if you put in the stock market, even when it is a pandemic, you would make 2x, 3x with big name stocks, because unless and until you are a crazy risk taker, you would do that. But startups will still give you multiple growths, like more than 10x. Like if I have to talk about Bharat Pay, right, which went at the Unicorn Club this time, it gave investors 88x growth, okay?
Main ameer hoon.
And that is insane amount of growth. And the whole reason why Bharat Pay was able to do that was, when you go to a shop today, you don't want to give him cash, because cash, your contact, and then, there's a chance that you may end up spreading corona because of that. Especially 1.5 years back.
What to say?
And Bharat Pay was able to monetize on this very quickly. It made sense for people to use the QR code and start making payment. And Bharat Pay has this unique proposition where all the apps, whether it was Google Pay, Phone Pay, Paytm, whatever UPI code you had, you could see your total earnings in one single page. Right? And as a user, you don't want to have 5 apps to do that. That aggregation mode really helped Bharat Pay to get so many users.
But is it true that is it true, let us say in a scenario of COVID or global economy is going down, will this hypothesis be correct that an investor should rather invest in startups and not in traditional business because they are anyway suffering?
Not really, because there are items which will never go down. Like for example, because it was pandemic, it is not that you are not going to take bath. Do you think soaps will drop down? Do you think an FMCG company's growth is going to go down? Rather, it went up.
The lockdown did not create an investment glut, or did it create an investment?
No. No, the lockdown. People are always speculating, right? We love to speculate. We like to say that ye ho gaya for ye, things are going to go down. A lot of people, because the general tendency is if something is going on, you want to be the mob mentality and follow the mob, right? Which is 80%. There is this 80% weight equity rule applicable everywhere. But one very interesting startup which defied all of this and went into this space and became a unicorn was Cred.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
What happened with Cred was Kunal said that, I don't want to do into get into the bottom of the pyramid, which everyone is talking about. I don't want to cater to 1.5 billion people, but I want to cater to the creme de la creme, that is, you know, 1%, and ensure that, you know, because these are the guys, again, when he said the 80-20 rule, he said these 20% of the people are buying 80% of the stuff. Why not have a database?
The thing is, how can Cred is a very young company, and how can Cred achieve a unicorn status in such a short time, which I think is 2 years?
Yeah,
I'm not really sure. Or even less than 2 years, I guess. So, Cred, Cred is one of those companies which has entered unicorn this year. But the point which I'm asking, or I'm trying to really extract, is how come it could grow such fast?
Correct. So, why do you need money, right, as a startup? You need money to market yourself, to ensure you're getting that growth, to push yourself or market yourself. Cred realized that there is this unique opportunity that they can find out the one top 1% earning people in the country and target them. So, in total number of taxpayers in India is 3%. So, of which they then diversified, saying that who are the ones who are actually the best amongst them. And they got them all into a single platform. And second is Kunal Shah, the face value. A person who has already gone through the whole cycle phase, right? He has sold a company for $500 million. Been as a managing director on an Adish or on a pseudo level managing Sequoia fund for quite some time, for 1 or 2 years. So he's gone through the whole cycle, right, of a startup. So on his face value, anybody would bet. And so that is the reason why he was able to quickly raise so much of fund, because people know that if he's taking the fund, he will definitely be able to achieve that growth and give the investors back even faster.
So yeah, so because Kunal Shah is associated with FreeCharge, which is also a pretty big company in its time, so that credibility is still there with him. And the idea he's saying is that, you know, rich people are on a platform and you really want to market to rich people. And you know, if you're marketing on Facebook, you really can't distinguish. I want to market to people who have a salary less than or greater than 1 lakh, 2 lakh, 3 lakh, but on Cred, you have premium customers who have good credit score, which is means they are trusted, they are trustworthy. If you pitch them an EMI plan, they will most probably follow through, which means a bank would like to advertise its loan, its EMI plan on Cred.
A bank, now Cred has come with Cred Mint. So they themselves are going to lend. Just imagine that you are going to lend me 100 rupees and you're going to get 108 rupees back.
Samajh rahe ho?
For sure.
Because you know, I'm A plus category, and Cred has already checked my credit score and it knows credit worthy score. And they know that I'm going to pay back. Rather, they've made it so amazing now that they can defy even the credit scoring companies like Experian or someone, because they have actual data on how I'm performing. With, you know, because I'm making payments via my credit score. So now they have taken one step further. They have an opportunity to become the next, you know, experience on creating this platform or rating system.
Guys, I don't use credit cards, so he uses credit cards, so he knows more about credit. Okay guys, the next company which we're going to talk about is PharmEasy, which raised $323 million in Series E, taking its valuation across $1 billion valuation. So that's one company which has also entered into pharma, and I think this is the first pharma company, e-pharma company, to enter into the unicorn club. And also the one reason I believe this happened is because, again, it's medicines. People were buying a lot of medicines during COVID times, not just COVID, but all the associated medicines.
Correct.
And
I know how we filled our houses with all, COVID precaution medicines even before we never really wanted.
And when we got COVID, we had such a huge medicine, stock in our houses. / offices. And so one thing is, and also PharmEasy, actually, you know, PharmEasy co-founder is from my college.
Yeah.
So this time two of the startups which have entered into Unicorn Club are from XLRI. One is Grow and one is
I think you've understood, you know, why we said that, because I'm going to be the next one. Actually, there is a rule in India which says that you cannot sell medicine unless and until you have a pharmacy degree. Okay, and if you want to open a medical store in India, you need to have pharmacy degree. Okay. So PharmEasy could never really sell on its name because none of them were pharmacists right, in that way. So what they had to do was they had to create a marketplace where a pharmacist who had a medical store would become like a hub for them and then distribute it to all of them.
Okay.
So that is the whole licensing thing that actually required. So basically having a medical store in India is more of a licensed game because you need to be a pharmacist to run that whole show.
So you guys, next company that we're going to discuss is ShareChat, which raised $500 million in Series E round, guys. ShareChat has been there for a pretty long time. I actually use ShareChat, okay? And ShareChat, one primary reason I would say is that the reason it has actually shot to unicorn status, not just is the lockdown, but I think the TikTok was banned sometime back. When TikTok got banned, a lot of apps came into picture. Takatak, Chingari, Josh, and you know, a lot of apps are there. But ShareChat was doing this for a pretty long time. And ShareChat, the only difference was it did not have reels in the starting, okay? Many of you may not use ShareChat. It's a good
Indian app, vernacular
app for vernacular.
Okay.
Languages for regional people in all the languages are there. But it has a lot of good features now. It has rooms. And people love it, especially people in tier 1, tier 2, tier 3 cities, they love it. And so I knew that once TikTok was banned, ShareChat had complete space. These guys had to come, Takatak and all, but ShareChat was already there and it also launched Moj.
Correct.
So Moj is also there, ShareChat is also there, and both have pretty good amount of users. And somewhere around 1 crore users they already have, daily active users, that's what they claim. And it is, so it is no brainer that they're going to enter unicorn status. It's founded by IIT Kanpur alumni.
Correct.
Okay, next company that has entered unicorn status is Gupshup, which raised more than $100 million in Series F round by Tiger Global. Gupshup is a conversational marketing platform that provides API solutions to businesses. Even we are going to use it. It's a pretty big platform, guys. Most of the marketing companies are using it. So for example, if I want to market something through WhatsApp, I'll use Gupshup, and it will also provide me bot solutions and answering solutions and of all those, you know, sort of kind of solutions.
Okay.
So another interesting startup in the space was Zeta, which went into the Unicorn Club, right? Zeta is actually by Bhavin Tolakia, who happened to be one of the earlier startup founders, in which startup was not a very jazzy thing, because Bhavin was someone who started DirectAI, which actually was a software company which helped build a lot of apps and websites, etc. And they were very innovative back then. And Bhavin then decided to start Zeta somewhere, I think in 2015, where he wanted to give food coupons in a different way to employees. And that's when they came up with the Zeta card. And there's an interesting fact that in India, you can pay your employee 50 rupees per day in a card format, in a coupon format, which Sodexo used to then exploit on, because that becomes tax-free for them. So if you give them 1,500 rupees worth of food coupons, that becomes tax-free for them from the total income. And with the earlier tax system, it made a lot of sense for companies to give 2,500 rupees worth of coupons. But as and when you started getting this Sodexo coupons, paper management became very tough, etc.
Mm-hmm.
Zeta came up with this concept of a card system where you could swipe anywhere and you can start using these systems for withdrawing and start paying for food.
Mm-hmm.
And it so happened that they partnered with Sodexo, because Sodexo realized that they are going to lose out a lot of market.
Mm-hmm.
If their paper system is going to go out of use. So they partnered with Sodexo, and they also had a partnership where they would have this POS machines where they could start swiping.
The next company which we'll talk about is Urban Company, which raised $188 million in Series F round led by Process. Urban Company was earlier Urban Club, and we all know Urban Company, we use Urban Company. It's a pretty good company. It's a company that I admire for its service, and it's amazing that the way they have structured and where they have organized things on their platform. Now my question, Akshay, is that did it take pretty much long time?
Nahin.
Yeah. So Urban Companies, aka Urban Club, also wanted to find out what its mojo is, right? And they did a lot of services. They did painting, they did packing and moving, they did salon, they did so many things in the beginning. They were even becoming an aggregator where they would give partners, you know, like an IndiaMART platform where they could give partners leads and you could buy into all of those things. But finally they found their mojo in salons and beauty. And you know, they were doing well, and the pandemic kind of gave them such a great impetus, because you did not want to go to a barber. You wanted it because you were so used to the fact that you had to stay home.
Pandemic was the ultimate boost at the end of the day.
Correct. Yeah. So then their salon business really kicked off. And you know, what I'm really amazed about Urban Company is the service. Cracking a service business is extremely difficult, because every individual will behave differently.
What to say?
And you need to somehow control and ensure that the processes are so tight and strict that each and every person is, you know, behaving the same way as you want, the company would want, right?
The training process to be so rigorous. Like, if somebody is giving a massage to someone, you need to have some certain steps, where to keep oil, where to keep this, when to wash towel, when to, and you can't even see the person when he's doing that. So, you know, how do you really do that? That's
right.
A very big
thing. Just imagine that some guys come to cut your hair and you just don't like the haircut, right? Then how do you control that?
Yeah.
Right? So how do you control that the barber who's coming to cut your hair is actually doing a good job?
The process is so tight that in COVID, every time the person came, he would take his photo with the mask, and I'm wearing the mask with the gloves, which was, I mean, a very good process move, I believe.
Correct. And also spreading out the whole, you know, towel in place, carrying the mirrors, ensuring that whole, you know, you would really carry the whole salon with you.
The process is standardized. I mean, if I had service from barber 1 or barber 2, it really didn't make much difference, because their process was pretty standard. The questions they asked were pretty standard. So it's a very good thing.
I'm really impressed by, you know, it has taken them that whole journey to move in that direction, and then finally I think they found that mojo over there.
Yeah.
And what the other thing that I have realized that what Urban Company has done is now they started really expanding these services across the globe. I personally know some guys who have now become head of, you know, they're in Saudi Arabia. Didn't know that. They're in Saudi Arabia where they're giving these services. They're in Australia. They're building these newer markets where services are needed, and they're trying to replicate what they did in India. I just have one question for you. What do you think of the name?
Name, Urban Company. Why did it change from Urban Clap to Urban Company?
I think it was getting too complicated.
Urban Clap, I like Urban Clap. But I think, why do I get a feeling Urban Clap is a furniture company? I don't know. What do you like? You like Urban Clap or Urban Company?
I like neither. I think it is too complicated.
I like Urban Company. So guys, the next company which entered this Unicorn Club was Upgrade, which raised $185 million by Temasek. So Upgrade is third Indian edtech startup which has entered into Unicorn Club. Which one are the previous two startup? Come on, man. One that everybody knows.
Baiju
is the first one, and second one is Unacademy. So this is the third company in
Unacademy. Unacademy. Especially after the buyback that they did. But then all the hype around edtech, I actually expected a lot more edtech unicorns than.
Yes, I also, because there are many companies in edtech. So, but I think it's coming up.
It is also a very hot space for the investors too, right?
In lockdown, edtech is a very hot space, because everybody and a lot of students are now learning in digital media.
Correct. So the story about Upgrade, right? Why do you think they became a unicorn?
Upgrade, I believe, is into a market which not many players are. I think Upgrade is more into the professional skill kind of thing.
I personally feel that a lot of companies, right, moved their L&D process, which is learning and development, to Upgrade, because they could not conduct sessions in person. So they kind of gave everybody coupons saying that why don't you go to Upgrade and start learning. The second thing that happened, a lot of these companies used to purchase inventory of these educational programs, and which they have to buy on a very big subscription, pay for it. Yeah. But in this way, it has become per user or per usage time, right?
Yeah.
And that's what Grab actually did, broke it down to an employee level, so the cost brings down to the employee level. And L&D process can also be done. And then the tracking system also was already built in. All these companies, big companies, did L&D with a measure to track the L&D, but Upgrad was able to do it in a very different way, on an online platform way, where the cost would really come down for an organization.
So we will be closing this discussion. Also, I want to inform you that India's first crypto startup, that is called DCX, also entered into a unicorn club. So good news for Bitcoin enthusiast and blockchain enthusiast. Pharmacy, I've already told you, Pharmacy entered into this club. Let's see how, where this market goes. We still have good 4 months left to the end of the year. Let us hope that more and more unicorns come from India. Okay, which were the major investment houses that were involved in this?
Okay.
I think this, I would like to remember, is Tiger Global and
SoftBank. Correct. So I think they have always been the front runners in funding these companies. In the early stages, you would typically want someone like an Axel, Elevation, Matrix, Sequoia. Sorry if I missed someone.
Yeah.
But in the later stage, someone like a SoftBank, Tiger, coming onto your board really helps you to kind of get that impetus to move you in the next round.
Maybe you can do a video on what is funding and investment.
Yeah, and who comes in at which stage? Because a lot of what's the difference between a VC, a PE, or an angel network, and you know where you should be looking out for raising funds for your startup.
Yeah.
I think we can talk about it in the next video here.
Sure.
So, Vaibhav, I just wanted to ask you, when does a startup actually become unicorn?
What is the definition of unicorn? When its valuation reaches more than $1 billion is the standard definition of a unicorn. The question is...
Why unicorn? Why the term unicorn?
I don't know.
Yeah, I tell you. The term unicorn actually came because unicorns are so rare, right? And you don't find unicorns. So in the earlier days, it was about which startup can grow all the way up to $1 billion, which was so rare that it would become a unicorn, which is now you can't really see anywhere.
Because unicorns are so rare.
And today, I think we need to move the whole concept of unicorn. To Decacon, which is $10 million and plus.
The companies are crossing $10 billion mark as well.
But there are very few again, right? But then the $1 billion, I think, has now become an open playground, right? With so many startups coming into place. But it's a very good thing that we are actually seeing this phenomenon. I don't want to jinx it.
So the valuation is basically after the funding round is only when you can establish that the company has entered that particular valuation, right?
Correct.
Okay.
Ever tried, ever failed, no matter, try again, fail again, fail better, the world is yours. I'm gonna reactivate your hips and push your ass out, gotta put the woman in so bad I'm about to pass out, wanna dig you, and I can't even lie about it baby, just alleviate your clothes, I'ma fly about it, catch you at the club, your hips have got me feeling, body talking through to me, but I think I bring the meaning, now if you wanna roll with me, then get some chance for your lady on the freeway, catch me if you can. Still, I'm just a simple man. All I want is money plus the fame. I'm a simple man, Mr. International. Player with a passport, just like a Latin switch. Do anything you ask for, either him or me. The champagne, Hennessy, favorite of my homies when we toss on our enemies. Witnesses, we creep to a low speed. Beat what my foes need. Make some OG.